Yes, yes.
Buenas tardes. Bienvenidos a la sede del Instituto Interamericano para la Agricultura, a quien agradecemos muchísimo que nos haya facilitado estas instalaciones para celebrar esta reunión en las mejores condiciones. Muchas gracias de nuevo, señor director. Y ahora se va a leer la declaración del Grupo de Lima. Primero lo hará en inglés la señora Mogherini y después lo haré yo en español. Muchas gracias. Si alguien necesita interpretación, aquí están los audífonos. Gracias.
Thank you. Let me start by thanking the foreign minister, my good friend Manuel, and the authorities of Costa Rica for an excellent hospitality and a very useful way of hosting us all that has contributed to a very productive meeting. I'm now going to read as established practice the English version of the draft of the statement of the International Contact Group. The International Contact Group met on the 6th and 7th of May in San Jose, Costa Rica, at ministerial level. Concerned by the recent events in Venezuela, the group members renewed their commitment to a political, peaceful, democratic, and Venezuelan-owned solution through the holding of free and fair presidential elections as soon as possible. The International Contact Group reaffirms its strong rejection of the use of force against civilians and expresses its deep condolences to the families and friends of the victims. The group urges the security forces to act with utmost restraint to avoid further loss of life and suffering. Irregular armed groups must be disbanded. Those responsible for indiscriminate violence will be held accountable. The right to peaceful protest must be respected and demonstrations should remain nonviolent. The group firmly condemns acts of violence against journalists and underlines that media freedom must be respected. The priority now is to avoid further escalation of an already extremely tense situation. For this, it is imperative to reinstate democracy, rule of law, and separation of powers. Current events confirm that the only sustainable way out of the current crisis is an inclusive, democratic, and peaceful one in the framework of the country's constitution. No actions of a repressive, judicial, or political nature should be taken that would make this possibility more remote. The International Contact Group firmly condemns flawed judicial processes aimed at criminalizing protests and political opinions, such as the proceedings initiated against several representatives of the National Assembly. Party leaders and members need to be able to carry out their work peacefully, without intimidation and reprisals. The democratically elected National Assembly, under its president, Juan Guaido, should remain in the center of the political life in the country. Its constitutional prerogatives should be respected, and in accordance with its national legislation, the parliamentary immunity of its members should be fully guaranteed. In this regard, the group also condemns the enforced disappearance of Representative Gilbert Caro, whose fate and whereabouts remain unknown. It holds the relevant authorities responsible for his safety and integrity. Building on the work done since the Quito Ministerial Declaration, the International Contact Group stresses that the best way forward lies in a credible, negotiated political process, with the objective of bringing the country to democratic elections. This requires urgent, meaningful confidence-building measures, such as the release of political prisoners and changes in the respective branches of power in order to make them independent and accountable. The International Contact Group will continue to support and facilitate efforts that can allow the country to move in this direction. The International Contact Group expresses its deep concern about the suffering of the Venezuelan people caused by increased insecurity and the continued deterioration of the humanitarian situation, which has been further exacerbated by the lack of electricity and water supply in many areas of the country. In view of this, The group fully supports the ongoing efforts of the United Nations to establish an effective humanitarian response system and to deliver assistance to those most in need. In this regard, it also underlines the urgent need for a substantial humanitarian response that is commensurate with needs and in full compliance with humanitarian principles and with Resolution 46182 of the UN General Assembly. It is important and urgent that humanitarian organizations have unimpeded access and can effectively deliver and significantly scale up assistance swiftly, without constraints, free from any political interference. The International Contact Group commends the progress made since its last meeting in the functioning of the humanitarian response system working under the umbrella of the Equipo de Coordinación, de Cooperación y Asistencia, and in the delivery of humanitarian support to people in need, and notes the important contribution of the International Contact Group to these efforts. However, the implementation capacity is still weak compared to the scale of need. The International Contact Group, therefore, calls for further steps to facilitate the establishment of additional specialized national and international organizations, in particular international NGOs, in the country, and to facilitate deployment of humanitarian operations on the ground in accordance with commitments made by the relevant actors. To follow up on these commitments and to step up work in support of the Equipo de Coordinación, de Cooperación y Asistencia, the International Contact Group will set up a humanitarian working group in Caracas. The group calls on donors to enhance contributions. The donor community should coordinate more effectively, and the International Contact Group welcomes the European Union proposal to host a first meeting with this purpose. While the solution to Venezuela's crisis needs to come from Venezuelans, the international community has a duty and a responsibility to contribute to creating the conditions for peace, democracy, rule of law, and human rights to prevail in Venezuela. In this respect, having reviewed its contribution so far, the International Contact Group has decided to continue its work, subject to periodical assessment of progress made. The International Contact Group is ready to undertake a mission at political level in Caracas to present and discuss concrete options for a peaceful and democratic solution to this crisis. The International Contact Group will continue to engage with its regional and international partners towards a political, peaceful, and democratic solution. It welcomes the participation of the Chilean Minister of Foreign Affairs, the Prime Minister of St. Kitts and Nevis in its capacity of Chair of the CARICOM, the Secretary General of the CARICOM, and the representative from the Holy See in the outreach session of this meeting today. It also welcomes and accepts the invitation extended by the Lima Group of countries to meet. It has decided to have similar exchanges with CARICOM countries and other relevant interlocutors. The group has also decided to convene again at ministerial level in the near future to assess developments and decide next steps. Thank you.
Declaración del Grupo Internacional de Contacto, reunión ministerial San José, Costa Rica, del 7 de mayo. 1. El Grupo Internacional de Contacto se reunió dos días, 6 y 7 de mayo, en San José, Costa Rica, a nivel ministerial, preocupados por los recientes acontecimientos acaecidos en Venezuela. Los miembros del Grupo Internacional de Contacto renovaron su compromiso con una solución pacífica, política, democrática y decidida por los propios venezolanos, mediante la celebración de elecciones presidenciales libres y justas lo más pronto posible. El Grupo Internacional de Contacto reafirma su fuerte rechazo al uso de la fuerza contra civiles y expresa sus profundas condolencias a las familias y amigos de las víctimas. El grupo insta a las fuerzas de seguridad a actuar con la máxima moderación, con el fin de evitar más pérdidas de vida y sufrimiento. se debe desmantelar a los grupos armados irregulares. Los responsables de la violencia indiscriminada tendrán que responder. Se debe respetar el derecho a la protesta pacífica y las manifestaciones deben seguir siendo no violentas. El grupo condena firmemente los actos de violencia contra periodistas y resalta que la libertad de los medios debe respetarse. La prioridad ahora consiste en evitar una mayor escalada de una situación que es ya de por sí sumamente tensa. Por esta razón, es imperativo restaurar la democracia, el Estado de Derecho y la separación de poderes. Los actuales acontecimientos confirman que la única salida sostenible de la crisis actual es una que sea inclusiva, democrática y pacífica, en el marco de la Constitución del país. No se debe tomar ninguna medida de índole represivo, judicial o político que aleje más esa responsabilidad. El Grupo Internacional de Contacto condena firmemente los procesos judiciales viciados, destinados a criminalizar las protestas y las opiniones políticas, tales como las acciones emprendidas contra varios representantes de la Asamblea Nacional. Los dirigentes y miembros de los partidos necesitan poder llevar a cabo su trabajo de manera pacífica, sin intimidación ni represalias. La Asamblea Nacional, elegida democráticamente y presidida por Juan Guaidó, debe seguir siendo el centro de la vida política del país. Sus prerrogativas constitucionales deben respetarse de conformidad con su legislación nacional. La inmunidad parlamentaria de sus miembros debe estar plenamente garantizada. En este respecto, el grupo también condena la desaparición forzada del diputado Gilbert Caro, cuyo destino y paradero siguen siendo desconocidas. Responsabiliza a las autoridades pertinentes de su ciudad, de su seguridad e integridad. Con base en la labor realizada desde la labor ministerial de Quito, el Grupo Internacional de Contacto insiste en que la mejor forma de proceder se basa en un proceso político creíble, negociado, con el objeto de llevar al país hacia elecciones democráticas. Esto requiere de medidas urgentes, significativas, para forjar confianza, tales como la liberación de presos políticos y cambios en los respectivos poderes del Estado, a fin de volverlos independientes y que rindan cuentas de sus actos. El Grupo Internacional de Contacto seguirá apoyando y facilitando esfuerzos que le pueden permitir al país avanzar en esa dirección. El Grupo Internacional de Contacto expresa su profunda preocupación por el sufrimiento del pueblo venezolano ocasionado por la mayor inseguridad y el continuado deterioro de la situación humanitaria, la cual se ha exacerbado aún más con la falta de electricidad y abastecimiento de agua en muchas zonas del país. En vista de lo anterior, el Grupo Internacional de Contacto apoya plenamente los esfuerzos en marcha de las Naciones Unidas por establecer un sistema eficaz de respuesta humanitaria y prestar asistencia a los más necesitados. En este respecto, también resalta la urgente necesidad de una respuesta humanitaria, sustancial, conmesurada con las necesidades y en pleno cumplimiento con los principios humanitarios y con la resolución 46-182 de la Asamblea General de las Naciones Unidas. Es importante y urgente que las organizaciones humanitarias tengan un acceso irrestricto y puedan prestar con eficacia e intensificar significativamente la asistencia con rapidez, sin restricciones y libre de cualquier interferencia política. El Grupo Internacional de Contacto elogia los avances logrados desde su última reunión en el funcionamiento del sistema de respuesta humanitaria, que trabaja bajo el paraguas del equipo de coordinación, de cooperación y asistencia, y en la entrega del apoyo humanitario a la gente necesitada, y reconoce la contribución importante del Grupo Internacional de Contacto a estos esfuerzos. Sin embargo, la capacidad de implementación aún es débil en comparación con el grado de necesidad. Por consiguiente, el Grupo Internacional de Contacto hace un llamado para que se den más pasos que faciliten el establecimiento adicional de organizaciones especializadas e internacionales, en particular el equipo de coordinación y asistencia. El Grupo Internacional de Contacto establecerá un grupo de trabajo humanitario en Caracas. El grupo hace un llamado a los donantes para que intensifiquen sus contribuciones. La comunidad de donantes debe coordinarse más eficazmente y el Grupo Internacional de Contacto da la bienvenida a la propuesta de la Unión Europea de auspiciar una primera reunión con ese fin. Si bien la solución a la crisis de Venezuela debe venir de los propios venezolanos, la comunidad internacional tiene el deber y la responsabilidad de contribuir a crear las condiciones para que en Venezuela prevalezcan la paz y la democracia, el Estado de Derecho y los derechos humanos. Al respecto, después de haber examinado su contribución hasta el momento, el Grupo Internacional de Contacto ha decidido continuar su labor, sujeto a la evaluación periódica de los avances logrados. El grupo está listo para llevar a cabo una misión de alto nivel en Caracas para presentar y discutir opciones concretas para una solución pacífica y democrática a la crisis. El Grupo Internacional de Contacto continuará interactuando con sus socios regionales e internacionales con miras a una solución política, pacífica y democrática. Acoge la participación del canciller chileno, el primer ministro de San Cristóbal y Nieves, en calidad de presidente del CARICOM, el secretario general del CARICOM y el representante de la Santa Sede, en la sesión de trabajo con socios internacionales. En este sentido, también da la bienvenida y acepta la invitación extendida por los países del Grupo de Lima para reunirse. Se decidió mantener intercambios similares con el CARICOM y otros interlocutores relevantes. El grupo también decidió reunirse de nuevo a nivel ministerial a corto plazo para evaluar los avances y decidir los próximos pasos. Esta declaración ha sido acordada por los siguientes miembros del Grupo Internacional de Contacto: la Unión Europea, 8 de sus estados miembros, Francia, Alemania, Italia, Países Bajos, Portugal, España, Suecia y el Reino Unido, y 3 países de la América Latina, Ecuador, Costa Rica y Uruguay. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias. Iniciamos el periodo de preguntas y respuestas. Pregunta a la televisión. Se identifica y nombre, el medio y a quién dirige la pregunta, por favor. Gracias.
Buenas tardes. Armando Gómez, de CB24. Mi pregunta va para la señora Mogherini. Vamos a ver, estas reuniones, ya se han hecho 2 reuniones, una en Uruguay y otra en Quito. ¿En qué se diferencia concretamente esta tercera reunión a las dos anteriores? ¿Y qué sigue? Porque esa es la pregunta que hacen muchos venezolanos.
You will excuse me if I will answer in English. This is, I think, exactly 3 months after our first meeting in Montevideo. What we have decided today is definitely the decision to step up the work of the International Contact Group, as we have together assessed that the group has developed in this 3 months of work. First of all, the unique capacity to have access to all relevant interlocutors, both inside Venezuela, in the region, and in the global scene. And we have managed to open, for the first time maybe, the initial steps, the initial space for the humanitarian assistance to the country. First steps that need now to be consolidated. This is why the first practical result of our meeting today is our decision to set up a group of the International Contact Group in Caracas on the humanitarian work to monitor the developments, the follow-up of the engagements and the commitments that have been taken in these recent months. Thanks to the fact that we have sent several missions at technical level to Caracas on the humanitarian work, but also on the political developments. So first concrete outcome is that we have decided to have a constant presence in Caracas as a group to accompany the humanitarian assistance in the country in the most effective manner, as all our interlocutors in Venezuela, but also in the UN system and in the NGOs, tell us that our work in this respect has been vital, but still it's not enough. We need to continue. The second news, I would like to say, of today's meeting is the fact that we have discussed with the ministers what we have referred in the document as concrete options for a peaceful and democratic solution to the crisis. It's a set of ideas that we are not going to make public, but that we are ready to present and to discuss to different interlocutors in Caracas with a mission at a political level in the coming weeks, if there is interest to go in that direction. As we discussed yesterday with the president of Costa Rica, it is time to move to concrete ideas that could unblock the situation, and this group meeting has produced these concrete ideas quite in detail, so now we are ready to engage in the presentation and discussion of these concrete ideas. That would also require a certain level of confidentiality, so you will understand we will not share the details of that. Third new element for today's meeting is that we have decided to intensify our work with other interlocutors and partners in the region and the international community. You have seen that a few days ago in Lima, thanks also to the good coordination and good work that Costa Rica and El Canciller personally have done, being Costa Rica the only country member both of the International Contact Group and of the Lima Group. You have noticed that in Lima, the Lima Group has extended an invitation to the International Contact Group to have a meeting at ministerial level. And today we've decided to accept this invitation, so we will now get in contact with the Lima Group members in the coming hours to define a date and a place for this meeting to take place. And we've also decided, in parallel, to develop further our contacts and our coordination with other interlocutors that are relevant for a peaceful and democratic solution of this crisis, such as CARICOM, but also the permanent members of the Security Council, such as the United States, Russia, and China, beyond the two members, permanent members that are already members of our group, France and the UK, but also other players, other countries of the region, I think specifically to Cuba, to Mexico, or the Holy See that was present today with us, with a representative, that can be of help in case the Venezuelan parties would be ready to engage in a process. So I think that this has been maybe the most productive of the meetings of the contact group. Each time we meet, we see a situation in the country that deteriorates, and even more importantly, the need to urgently help or support, facilitate the Venezuelans themselves to find their own way out of this crisis. Thank you.
Buenas tardes, Rebeca Madrigal del periódico La Nación. La primera pregunta es para doña Federica. Cuando se creó el grupo, usted decía que los 90 días no eran inamovibles, pero que continuarían si se veían dinámicas positivas y constructivas hacia la organización de elecciones. Entonces, mi pregunta es, ¿cómo lo justifica? O sea, ¿ustedes ven gestos en Venezuela que indiquen que van hacia nuevas elecciones? Y tal vez a don Manuel, si nos puede especificar un poco los detalles de este grupo de alto nivel, quiénes participarían, si diría usted personalmente en Caracas, si serán recibidos en Caracas, quiénes podrían ser los interlocutores de ustedes allá.
The international contact group was established with clear terms of references that have been made public from the very first day. And that clearly states that after 90 days of work, the group itself, the members of the group, would assess the results achieved and review the group, the work of the group. And our common assessment today is that some achievements have been reached, especially in the humanitarian field. Initial steps, not sufficient. But even more so, we see the need to continue to consolidate and expand these first results. All our interlocutors are encouraging us to continue the work of the group in this field, but also on the political track. I believe that it is clearly too early to say that there are signs inside Venezuela of willingness to go in the direction of early, fair, and transparent presidential elections. But I believe, and I think we shared the assessment together with all the members of the group, but also with our interlocutors, for instance, that joined us today, that especially in these last days, it is self-evident inside the country that the only way forward, the only way to unblock a stalemate in which the country clearly is to find a democratic, peaceful, political way forward that can be inclusive and that can respect the will of the Venezuelan people. This is why, as I said, we have decided together to continue our work with the group and to offer as a contribution to this perspective of a peaceful Venezuelan democratic solution, some concrete ideas and options as a contribution that then will be up, obviously, to the Venezuelan parties and interlocutors and different sectors of society to discuss and decide upon. It's a contribution that we offer, knowing very well that the solution will have to come from inside Venezuela, but we feel a responsibility to contribute if we can.
Muchas gracias. El Grupo Internacional de Contacto consideró hoy que está listo para enviar un grupo de naturaleza política a Venezuela para reunirse con las partes involucradas en el conflicto, con el propósito de seguir avanzando para que se puedan realizar lo antes posible elecciones supervisadas internacionalmente, creíbles, en Venezuela lo antes posible. ¿Quiénes formarán ese grupo? Es algo que todavía no ha sido decidido. Existen varias propuestas y la señora Mogherini las hará pública en los próximos días. Así que debemos esperar esa comunicación para saber quiénes formarán o integrarán ese grupo de naturaleza política, pero sí será de alto nivel.
Muchas gracias. Pregunta Josh Rodríguez por parte de las agencias internacionales de noticias.
Sí, doña Federica, usted ayer planteaba un par de cosas en la conferencia de prensa en la Cancillería que me parece muy importantes. Una, usted decía que en la situación actual en Venezuela no hay ganadores, algo en lo que estamos plenamente de acuerdo. Quería preguntarle, en ese sentido, ¿cómo ve el grupo el margen de tiempo? Porque es una situación que se ha desarrollado en el tiempo y de momento no hay salida. Y en el caso de los contactos, usted también ayer decía de tender puentes entre el grupo y otros actores. Se ha mencionado la participación de Cuba, se ha mencionado la participación de Rusia, no sé si hay previsto contacto con Estados Unidos, si nos puede dar detalles de eso.
First of all, on the time framework, as soon as possible. We all agreed on the urgency of intensifying our work, exactly because the first priority is to avoid negative developments. And I want to stress here the need to preserve, protect the constitutional role of the democratically elected National Assembly, of all its members, the parliamentary immunity of its members, and the need to avoid any move, any step in these hours, in these days, that could make a political solution more difficult in the coming weeks. So we share the urgency of first and foremost avoiding negative developments on the ground to be even further expanded and to avoid a violent cycle or development. We've been also very clear from the very beginning that we believe that there should be no military attempts, neither from within or from the outside of the country, to solve the crisis through military means or through the use of force in whatever form. So the sooner, the better. Because it is true there is no winner, but there are many losers in this situation, and they are all the Venezuelan citizens, many of which, more than 1 million of which, are also European citizens, and the rest of the region that is dramatically destabilized by a crisis that has the potential to impact even more from the stability of the region point of view in the coming weeks. So there is a sense of urgency. We believe that the next days and weeks are crucial to explore the possibility of engaging the different relevant interlocutors inside Venezuela into this concrete ideas on how the crisis can be unblocked politically and democratically and peacefully. The second part of the question on the contacts we have, being a contact group, not only with different parties inside Venezuela, but also we have contacts with all different regional and international interlocutors, no one excluded. Some of them are already ongoing. You mentioned Cuba. The Cuban foreign minister was visiting Costa Rica last week. I had a telephone conversation with him last Saturday. Not only about Venezuela, but also Venezuela was part of our discussions with the Chinese foreign minister when he last visited Brussels a few weeks ago. We have had contacts with both Moscow and Washington in these recent days, not only to inform about our work, but also to try and explore convergences, because the approach that the group is taking is that, again, the process needs, first of all, to start, but also to be fully Venezuelan. But the international community has a responsibility to create the conditions and accompany as much as possible this this process, if possible. So we have discussed today the need and the decision to intensify contacts and coordination with the Lima Group. upon their invitation that we value enormously, but also with CARICOM countries, with the US, with Russia, with China, with Cuba, with Mexico, with the Holy See, with others that can help creating a conducive environment for the Venezuelans to engage in a democratic and peaceful outcome of this crisis.
Gracias. Última pregunta. Como convenimos, era un representante de la prensa escrita, otro de la televisión, otro de las agencias y ahora uno de la radio. Fue un convenio entre ustedes. Y la última pregunta, por favor, con un ruego una vez que termine la conferencia, que es que permanezcan ahí mismo en sus sitios para hacer una salida ordenada de los señores participantes en la reunión. Muchas gracias.
Buenas tardes, Alan Arroyo de Radio Colombia. Dos consultas. El grupo de alto nivel que se enviaría políticamente a Venezuela, ¿dependería de la aceptación de ambas partes, del presidente Guaidó y del grupo o el régimen de Nicolás Maduro, para que ustedes puedan llegar y sentarse a conversar con ambas partes? Ese sería un requisito. Y bueno, sé que algunos países han ido tomando otras medidas como sanciones económicas, el retiro también de representaciones diplomáticas. ¿Cómo ven ustedes esas medidas que siguen siendo diplomáticas y que ejercen cierta presión para el gobierno actual de Venezuela o el régimen de Nicolás Maduro? Como grupo, ¿cómo ven también esas medidas y si es una posibilidad de hacer el llamado inclusive para que se intensifiquen? Muchas gracias.
We will explore in the coming hours, as the foreign minister has mentioned, the possibility of having this mission at a political level. As I mentioned, as I read, and as you can read in the statement, we offer an availability. We are ready to send a mission at political level. Let me stress that we have already sent several missions to Caracas in these last 3 months. If I'm not wrong, two on humanitarian issues and two on the political, if not three, on the political track. So this is not a first in itself, but we are ready to upgrade somehow the level of our political engagement, having a political nature of the next mission, if there is readiness and desire to hear our ideas and our proposals and discuss them in direct contacts at a political level. So we will explore this possibility in the coming hours. As I said, it's not a request, it's a readiness to engage further if required, if considered useful by different interlocutors in Caracas. There are a set of ideas of concrete options that we have worked upon and that we can offer to the different interlocutors as food for thought for them to consider further. So it is not a peace plan we're coming with. It's a set of options that we have identified as issues that might help moving forward and that we're ready to present and discuss if there is interest to do so. It's an offer. The issue of the pressure, here I cannot speak on behalf of the International Contact Group that by definition is composed by different countries and entities having different approaches to this, and this is also the richness of our contact group that has a certain diversity inside, but a convergence on the purpose of the work we're doing. But I can speak for the European Union. We have introduced last year some restrictive measures on some individuals in Caracas that have been responsible for some impediments and violations of democracy and human rights in their countries. I want to stress these are not sanctions against Venezuela and Venezuelan people, but these are targeted measures against some individuals that the European Union has taken on the sound, very sound legal basis, and that we're always ready to scale up or to take off in case, or to take away in case we see developments that's going in the right direction. This is an instrument the European Union uses when considered useful by our member states by unanimity, and that we have used last year exactly after the last presidential elections that we have not recognized. So I do not exclude that the member states of the European Union could take further decisions in one sense or another on this, but I cannot speak on behalf of the International Contact Group for this. Thank you.
Muchas gracias. Buenas tardes. Hemos concluido esta conferencia de prensa. Les ruego permanecer en sus sitios y dos recordarles que por favor, retornen los auriculares, los audífonos. Muchas gracias, permanezcan ahí. Ha concluido la conferencia de prensa de esta tercera reunión del Grupo Internacional de Contacto. Muchas gracias.
¿Por qué no firmó Bolivia la declaración?
This is not something new to this meeting of the contact group. Also, in the previous two meetings, Bolivia was actively participating to the works of the contact group, both during the ministerial meetings and in between. As I mentioned, we have sent several missions to Venezuela in these 3 months, and we've been working very closely together on preparing both the humanitarian and the political track. Bolivia has always been and continues to be an active and positively contributing member of the group, but since the very first meeting we had in Montevideo, the Bolivian delegation expressed the will not to sign the final declarations without impeding the rest of the members of the group to adopt it, and without leaving the group, but staying engaged in a way that the Bolivian delegation considers more productive for its own role inside the group. And we're very respectful for that. We're also, I would say, very grateful for the very constructive approach that the Bolivian colleagues have always shown in these 3 months, and we will continue to work together very closely.
Muchas gracias, muy amable, las señoras periodistas. Buenas tardes.